Welcome to the long overdue second part of my vehicle tutorial series. In the next few parts, we'll be recreating the track on which you see the car driving around. A number of issues with the vehicle body were fixed in Godot 304. As you can see, the car drives around a lot more stable. For the next few parts, however, we will be using a recent build of Godot 3.1, as it allows us to generate and alter our track in Godot itself. If you want to keep using Godot 3.0, you will need to use 3D modeling software to create a track. Software like Blender has similar features that allow you to create a track in the same way. There are, however, a number of advantages to doing this work inside of Godot, as you will see. We are going to start by laying out our track as a curve. We'll first create a container spatial node. Then we will add a path node. The path node contains the curve, which is a separate resource. This will come in handy much later on in the series. We'll make sure that the curve is selected. Note these four icons that are added to the interface that allow us to modify our curve. The blue icon lets us modify the points of the curve. The green icon lets us add a new control point. The red icon lets us remove control points. And the last icon closes the curve. What I like to do to set up my initial curve is to press on the display label in the top left corner. This brings up a menu that allows us to configure the display. I want to show a top view and switch the view into ortho view. This ensures my points are all created at the same height. I've clicked on the green Add button and I'm now just clicking away to create my basic shape of the track. I'm going for a real rough outline. We can improve upon it later. Now finally, I click on the Close Curve button to join the start and end of the curve together. This creates the end point of our curve on our start point, but they are still separate points. We'll look into the consequences of that later on. Now let me turn the ground plane off because it's hard to see our track. Note how the HDRI looks really funny in ortho mode. We're now going to create actual bends in our track. This is where curves really shine. You do this by shift-clicking on our control nodes and then dragging the control handles out. There are two for each control point. We're still going for a rough outline here. Just experiment with placing the control handles and getting a basic shape for our track. Let me fast forward to doing this for each point. No point in seeing me fiddle around with this for half an hour. Now for the tricky bit. I want to add some height into the track, but this is where the interface could use modifiers for the curve handles that limit movement on a specific axis. Now you often end up moving the control points on an axis you didn't intend. It's fiddly, but you get there if you're careful with your view angles. Working in ortho mode really does help a lot here. I'll fast forward a bit more. We'll be fiddling around with the track some more later on. Now that we've got a bit of height in our curve, let's go back to perspective mode and create our actual track. We're going to use a brand new node type for this, which is part of the CSG module. One of the nodes that was added is called CSGPolygon, and this is a really powerful little node. First, we change its mode to path, which lets us extrude a shape along a path. Note that you'll see me deselect and reselect a node from time to time. The inspector code was recently overhauled, and this being a pre-alpha version of Godot, there are moments where something doesn't redraw. The next change is that we alter our path rotation to path follow. This ensures our extrusion properly follows the orientation of our curve. Next, we assign our path node as the polygon's path node. And here you can already see our track taking shape. Now note that currently our CSG polygon always seems to generate a shape that is inside out, so we need to invert it. This may be a bug, so I wouldn't be surprised that this will be changed before 3.1 is officially released. Luckily, we do have the invert option. Next up, we need to define the shape of our track. We don't want an extruded box. Our road is much flatter. This right now is a bit of a manual exercise. Hopefully someone will create an interface for this someday. I started by making the road really flat. After this, I made it wider. Now I'm starting here with a road that will be 4 units wide, as different parts of the track started overlapping, but we'll soon find out it is too small. However, this is where this technique shows its strengths. Because as I find out the track's layout isn't correct, I can start adjusting it to my heart's content. Let's move the car onto the track. Now you can easily see that the track is too small and not wide enough. The width is fixed easily enough by editing our polygon size. In the later part of the tutorial series, we'll start adding some logic so we can adjust these things on the fly. I'm going back into top view to further tweak the layout of the track. We'll continuously be tweaking it as we build more and more. And again, this is where the strength of this approach really shines. Let's fast forward once more through all this fiddling around. Next, I want to add a nice texture to our track. For now, we'll do something nice and simple, but I'm going to use a shader material for this. The main reason at this point in time is laziness. My texture is in the wrong orientation. If you want to know more about writing shaders in Godot, I'm working together with Nathan over at GDQuest on a complete shader tutorial for beginners. Note that whenever I have the road node selected, the frame rate really suffers. I think this is mainly due to the wireframe being rendered over our road surface while our poly count for our roads is fairly high. This is something to keep in mind, and again is hopefully something that will be addressed in the coming weeks. Finally, we turn our ground plane back on, and it's time for our first test run. Now that's not really successful. We're not driving on a road, we're driving through it. Luckily, all CSG objects have a wonderful new feature that instantly turns them into collision shapes. Simply turn on Use Collision. Well, that's loads better. Our car now drives on our track. However, oops, we can drive off of our track too. So we're not going to use our road as our collision shape. Obviously, if you have placed a road on top of a terrain and the terrain has a usable collision shape, this solution will work wonders. But for our demonstration, we are going to create a purpose-built collision shape for our track. You could see in my demo, way at the start, we'll eventually add barriers to the sides of our track, so we can create a collision shape with that in mind. We'll add another CSG polygon node to our scene, and we will assign the same path node. Our collision polygon will therefore be extruded along the same path as our road. It is on this polygon on which we'll turn on Use Collision. Now we need to define our polygon shape with 8 points instead of 4. We won't see our new shape form until we have set up all of these points. We're going to follow our shape over the road, but at the side of the road we're going to go up by 2 units and then wide by another 4. We want a big barrier like this. Because our car will be traveling at speed, our player could punch through a collision shape if they would be going fast enough and the shape wasn't wide enough. 4 might end up being excessive, but we have the space. We can hide our collision shape. This will not stop it from being evaluated by our physics engine. Now if you paid attention, you would have seen our collision mesh looking weird in the distance. This was because I had forgotten to turn on Path Follow. Let's go and test this out. Now I'm being a little careful here because I haven't added a reverse to our car yet and I can get stuck. But you see that we hit an invisible wall at the sides of our track. Exactly what we want. Okay, the final thing we'll look at in today's video is related to one small problem in the way the curve is processed. As you will remember from the start, we closed our path when we created it, but this simply places the last point in our curve in the same location as where we started. With our J-curve logic, it is very likely that the start and finish meet at a small angle. Not an issue when you're using the path to move a character around, but when you extrude a shape, that difference in angle can cause strange issues. You'll notice when I change the angle of our curve that suddenly gaps start to appear. It becomes even more clear when I pull the shapes apart. Now, with some fiddling, you can make sure they perfectly align. There is, however, a change currently being evaluated which will hopefully be added that allows you to simply join the two ends together. You will find this option on the CSGPolygon node and it is called Path Joint. We'll have to turn it on for both our polygons. This also removes the end caps, and if you have a shape that uses smooth normals, ensures you have the proper normals where the ends of our shape meet. And this is the end result for today's video. I've done a few more little tweaks on the track, but I'm pretty happy with our first step. As I mentioned, the beauty of this approach is not just that you can change the layout of the track in the game engine, it will update everything attached to it. Right now, that is just a collision shape, but we'll be adding much more in the upcoming videos. We'll also look at saving our nodes as a subscene in such a way that you can create a number of different tracks simply by creating different curve resources. But for now, this is all I have time to show you guys today. I've updated the project on my GitHub page so you can have a play around with it. The link is in the description below. Hope you enjoyed this. Until next time.